Violence against women. We're bringing you a report on those trying to stamp out violence against women just north of Paris. Here in France, each year there are some 201,000 women physically and or sexually abused by their current or former partner, but not many of them file a complaint. Our reporters have been to meet some of the men who were owning up to their acts.
The first time Marc hit his partner was back in 2008.
We argued, started shouting at each other. It's hard for me to put words on how I felt at the time. And I hit her in the sense that I wanted to cause her pain, because the words she used had hurt me so much. So she went straight to the police station and I was arrested a few minutes later.
Marc was placed in custody and brought before a judge. He was given a one-year suspended sentence and instructed to follow compulsory psychiatric treatment.
I myself got in contact with a psychiatrist. I had calmed down a bit, but unfortunately 2 months ago, I did it again. I started becoming violent again. I hit the girl I was with. I threatened to kill her even though I didn't mean it. But I know I've really hurt her, and I'm ashamed of myself.
Following his second arrest, a judge ordered Marc to stay away from his new girlfriend, cut all ties with her, pending the court ruling. Twice a week, Marc now heads down to the judicial and educational centre set up by a local NGO for his interview. He's also volunteered to attend open discussion meetings with other men who want to stop their violent behaviour.
It was somewhat of a revelation to see, after talking to others like me, that I wasn't alone, that, well, okay, we thought and reacted in similar ways, and the simple fact of discussing it between us really allowed me to work on myself.
In France, domestic violence is a criminal offense. The country's judicial system is designed to punish violent husbands and protect their victims, including their children. Yet, little is done to prevent repeat crimes, and perpetrators are rarely kept under watch.
Many people might say, wait, women are the victims here, and yet not only are you assisting these men, but you're also showing them compassion. But keep in mind that this man, if we don't work with him, the chances of a repeat offense are very high. Either he'll get back with his ex-wife, that happens very often, and it usually comes with fresh threats against her, or the relationship ends, but he'll get together with another woman, and it starts again the next day. They become violent. So assisting these men is vital.
Most social workers insist group therapy helps violent partners to open up, much more, in fact, than conventional interviews. But most court rulings are issued within 60 days of the arrest, and the judicial centre has very little time to get offenders to realise the extent of the damage they've caused.
Most of them have never really had anyone listen to them before, and they discover what it is to share their thoughts and meet other people like them. They come here, they talk. If they don't feel like talking, they don't. What they say stays confidential, and that's what makes the group stronger. They're not allowed to discuss what others have said with outsiders, and we're not supposed to discuss what they say with supervisors. And I think that makes them feel safe.
Men together tend to be very direct and blunt towards each other, but in a good way. The one who slapped his wife will find it totally unacceptable that a man could punch a woman in the face. Or the husband who threw something at his wife will disapprove of a man who violently pushed his partner on the kitchen floor. Perpetrators rarely admit to committing domestic violence. They very often find somebody else to blame. And if we don't work on this, on their denial, well, they'll never move forward.
In the actual moment, they tell us that they stop thinking. Their mind goes blank. It's pure violence. Our aim is to help them find a different approach to solving a problem, move forward at a psychological level, and find the right words to use.
When three out of the five men in a group ask for the support and help of a psychologist or an addiction specialist, well, it's clear that when they leave this place, they're heading down the right path.
In France, one in every 10 women can expect to experience domestic violence. A woman is murdered by her partner every other day.
And for more on this, I'm now joined in the studio by Annette Young, host of the 51%, who this week is focusing on the issue of ending violence against women. Hello, Annette. Now, domestic violence, the topic that, of course, that report was just focusing on, is only part of the problem. Violence against women is a global epidemic.
It really is, and the United Nations, Claire, has estimated some 35% of women have experienced violence at some points in their lives. In fact, of course, there are some countries where it's worse than others, because that's where cultural issues kick in. But the figures can be as high as some 7 in 10 out of 10 women experience violence or abuse, depending, of course, on where they are. And as you just said, it's not just domestic violence. It's really important to remember that this involves things such as honour killing, female genital mutilation, child abuse, trafficking, rape, and so on. So it covers a very, very broad issue indeed. And the thing is, it's not just an issue that we've saw there that's just restricted to the developing world. It's very much crosses all cultures, all societies. I mean, as you were saying, that, you know, somewhere I think in the order of 1 in 7 women here in France have experienced some form of violence. Police estimate that every third day a woman dies as a result of a violent act. So, you know, this is where it's a big problem. It's, as the World Health Organization calls it, a global epidemic. We're starting to see a bit of a change. I mean, the taboos are starting to sort of break down, and we're seeing that, for instance, in the treatment of celebrities or certain individuals. For instance, you know, last week the American pickup artist Julien Blanc was denied entry in the United Kingdom as a result of his seminars in which he shows men how to aggressively pick up, both physically and verbally, pick up women. And as a result of a social media campaign, that his visa was denied. And of course, more recently, we've seen the US celebrity Bill Cosby facing accusations as various women have come forward and alleged sexual and violent assaults.
And when famous men are accused of such acts, often there's a whole debate about it online. You see reactions on social media. Is it a friend or a foe?
Well, this is the thing. I mean, the fact of the matter is that social media has emerged as a key platform for women's voices. It's given them another way of basically telling the world what they've experienced, which itself is a very positive development. But yes, it can also have its dangers. And we know that women who do come forward and talk about their experiences are in danger of being what's known as trolled by accusers on the internet, which itself is very frightening. But, you know, you only have to look at what happened in Canada recently with the case of that very prominent radio host, Gian Gomeshi, who came forward and talked about the fact that he was facing accusations of violent assaults with women that he had dated. Now, as a result of that, a number of women started coming forward, but there was some discussion on social media. Why had those women taken such a long time to actually state what had occurred to them? And as a result, a Canadian journalist by the name of Sue Montgomery, who we actually interviewed in our program, started a whole campaign which she broadened out to talk about cases of rape, including her own, and she developed the hashtag Been Raped But Never Reported. And that just took off, and as a result, hundreds of thousands of women across the world have now basically used Twitter to talk about their experiences. And so, you know, social media has indeed opened the door to an honest and public conversation about domestic violence and other forms of violence. But women's activists, including the one that we spoke to in the program, say this has to be backed up with a very strong follow-through. And we just saw it there in the report, which is all well and good to, for instance, to arrest people. But you need to make sure, for instance, that there are programs in place that those men are immediately seeking some form of a therapy or support.
And attention needs to be focused also on changing men's attitudes towards violence against women.
They do indeed, and that's the bottom line. Because you can have as many laws as you like, you can have as many support groups as you like, you can have as many sort of, you know, condemnations, but at the end of the day, it is about changing men's attitudes. Now, one of our key guests in the program this week was a gentleman by the name of Gary Barker. He's the International Director of Promondo, which is a organization, a foundation that works in the developing world in re-educating men's attitudes when it comes to dealing with hostile behavior. Let's take a listen to what he had to say.
Understand that men, particularly in the lowest income parts of the world, to not have access to income and a sense of livelihood and the identity that most men derive from that, to acknowledge that that's a huge strain on men, I think is an important starting point. And again, it's not to make excuses for men. It's to say this is one of the sources of stress that men face. And that's particularly why we're trying to find spaces where men, where we know that stress comes to a fore. So we see that in many parts of the world, for example, there's sometimes a spike of men's use of violence against a pregnant partner. This stress of, oh, now I've got another mouth to feed, is a moment when we see a lot of violence show up. So we're trying to use the prenatal sector, and particularly prenatal visits for women, as a place to also reach out to male partners and provide the support so they don't end up using violence.
If you want to see more of that interview and the program itself, which is screened between now and Friday, you can also catch it online. Of course, that's www.france24.com. All right, thank you very much indeed, Annette. That's it for Focus. Let's go to a quick break. I'll be right back in a few minutes with the headlines for you. Don't go away.